Hello, and thanks for checking out the video. Today I'm going to take a look at a hill, and it's a hill in the range of hills that I normally hike around in, but it's actually the highest hill in the area, and it seems to have been a bit overlooked. You know, just a couple of miles or 2.5 miles from it, there's a very sort of, well, locally famous hill, which has a very big car park not far from it, and everybody heads there, you know, to take in the views. And I've been there many times myself on a video too, actually. You get a lovely 360 panorama. Yes, a very good place to go. But I noticed on the OS map, as I say, just a few miles from it, another summit, which was actually 6 meters higher, you know. And a little bit surprised that it seems to be, well, not ignored, but slightly overlooked. I realise it's off the actual footpath slightly, so the access to it would be limited at times if there's livestock or things like that. But I thought I'd check it out. When I talk about the summits of these hills around here, it's nothing exciting, nothing to write home about. You know, they're all under 250 metres high. Should be able to spot the peak of this little hill because it's got a trig point on the top of it. Yeah, pretty much 360 panorama views. At least as good as the other more popular hill just up the road. Right, to the woods. Cool. This lonely old beach surrounded by a conifer plantation. I've got a phone signal when I check the weather out, and although it's floating around 4 or 5 degrees centigrade at the moment, it is actually predicted to drop down to zero. That's freezing at midnight and all the early hours as well. So possibly it's saying it's possibly even going to drop 1 or 2 degrees below that. So I wasn't really expecting that. So the fire is going to be all important tonight. Tonight it's just sausage and beans, but I'm going to have some campfire damper, some campfire bread with that. Campfire damper or bannock is referred to as bread, but it's really a sort of a biscuit mixed, really. You know, it's an unleavened mix. This is a mixture of self-raising wholemeal and self-raising plain flour. It's always worth holding a little bit back in case you overdo the water. And I've got some vegetable oil here, so I'm just going to rub a bit of that through it. So you try and knead it as best as you can in such a tiny pot till you get a sort of workable play-doh. We'll divide that into two and let it rest for a while. I've got some dehydrated baked beans somewhere. These dehydrated baked beans were dried at home, very easy to do. Straight out of the tin into the dehydrator. The thing about the tinned legumes is I found that they, you know, on reheating them and rehydrating them, they can turn to mush. So best thing is to do it nice and slowly and gently if you can. You know, they can come out similar to like they are when they come straight out of the tin, if you get it right. I've got some vegan sausages here, which I'm going to skewer and cook over the fire. But I'm going to keep basting them in vegetable oil with my artist brush, in the hope that that'll make them cook slightly more like real sausages, you know. Probably haven't got a lot of oil, some fats in them that will come out. I've noticed when you grill these kind of things, they can get a bit dry and sort of brittle, you know. How comes when I start cooking, the smoke always starts coming into the shelter? Now I'm going to try and skewer the bread while the smoke pours into the shelter for some strange reason. Not to be confused with the sausage. Cover the baked beans with water and put them on a very gentle heat. Well, the beans turned out reasonably well. They're not too mushy, you know, you can still see that they're baked beans. So let's dig in. See what these vegan sausages are like when they've been basted with a bit of oil. Not bad. And the bread or biscuit bread, whatever you want to call it. Very edible, shall we say. As I sit here thinking on this cold, dark, late winter night, it's not lost on me the fact that I choose to be out here in the cold at night. Some tens of miles from here, the European continent, there are countries there where people are out at night. And through no choice of their own, you know. And be it man-made disaster that causes it due to conflict, or more recently on the Eastern Asian boundary with the European continent, natural disasters like earthquakes. Yeah, and it's hard not to, when you've got time to sit and think, to think about those people out in the cold that, you know, don't want to be out in the cold. that was quite a tough night really. The cold was sort of penetrating, and it was predicted to go down to 0 degrees with the possibility of it dropping 1 or 2 degrees below freezing, you know. So yeah, it was a case of the fire was everything really. So I had to make sure I kept it going. So it was the usual disturbed night, but it was really important to not let the fire die down, you know, especially in the early hours. And once it had died down quite a bit, you know, I really did feel the cold. But once the fire was going, yeah, it was possible to sleep. So that was a bit of a test really, that one.